Mira la izquierda. Mira la derecha. ¿Qué ves? ¿Dónde estás? In a world that seems to change daily, what will you do next? Welcome to the Next Steps Show with Peter Vasquez, a starting point for discussion y un poco de dirección. Buenas tardes, good afternoon, happy lunch hour, ladies and gentlemen. Si soy yo, tu conservative New Yorker, and hey, let's start off by saying to those that are from Canada, happy Canada Day. Did you know it was happy Canada Day today, Bob?
I did know that.
You did? Ah, well, for our
used to live in Canada, so that's,
I remember you saying that. Yeah. You didn't just live there. You actually were like a voice there on the air, weren't you?
I worked there, yes, at a very big Canadian station.
Very nice. So they know you there, too. But WYSL goes into Canada, so I thought that would be appropriate.
Hello, Southern Ontario.
Hey, before we go...
Sorry about that Trudeau guy. I hope you get rid of him soon.
Oh, my gosh, yes. Definitely sorry for him. That's sad. Did you guys know a couple tidbits on Canada since it is Canada Day? 23% of Canada's population is foreign-born. I don't know if you knew that. Canada is so big that it occupies 6 time zones. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm. I did. I got the Atlantic time zone.
There's such a thing as Newfoundland. Standard Time. Mm-hmm. Newfoundland Standard Time. And here, one more. Canada's national sport is hockey and lacrosse. Like, who doesn't know that, right?
A lot of curling, too.
Really? That I didn't know.
Oh, yeah.
Didn't know. Although I've never seen a game of curling. Someday I hope to. It is on my bucket list.
It's strangely engrossing. You would think people sliding a great big rock down basically like an ice-covered bowling alley would be like watching paint dry. But it's fun.
Hmm. I'll have to check it out then, definitely. Yeah. And one last thing is, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to echo the words of the former president and say today is definitely a big win for our Constitution and this great nation, as the Supreme Court ruled that, hey, guess what? A sitting president or a president does have immunity for official acts. And that's the way it should be for a lot of reasons.
God bless America.
Absolutely. Every once in a while, you know, you see this glimmer of hope. And it just kind of reminds us why we fight, why we do the things that we do, why radio stations like WYSL y La Voz de Libertad, you know, why we exist, why people like me, see the conservative New Yorker, decides to go against the narrative and say no mas, we're tired. You know what? My parents and my parents' parents didn't work so hard for freedom to end up in a situation where the government thinks that they can use our own resources like the judicial system against political foes. This is not a third world nation. And you know what? To talk about democracy, because even in the Middle East, we have an ally right now that was attacked, that here in this country, we've got people like the buffoon in the White House and even Hocus Pocus and even some local jokers that, yeah, we elected into office are saying things like, oh, you know what? Israel is wrong for doing what they're doing. And listen, I've said a million times, I'm no expert in Israel. I've never been there. The amount of people I know from there is a handful. So in order for us to talk about the war in Israel, it's important that we talk to people who know what's going on. I've had him on this show before. Actually, the last time he was on was on April 16th. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, it is my honor to introduce to you, right, the founder and the CEO of the Institute for Black Solidarity with Israel, the Honorable Pastor Dumisani Washington. Sir, thank you for joining us yet again.
Peter, it's great to be with you again. How are you guys doing?
We are doing just great, sir, just great. And tell me, how are you doing? How's everything with you, Pastor?
That's a long question. It's a short answer. Everything's well. Matter of fact, my wife and I just celebrated our 36th wedding anniversary last week.
Oh, that's fantastic. Good for you.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Yes, sir. Congratulations.
Well, the world is on fire, but God's been good. So, yes, sir.
Yeah, God, you know, and like I said, you know, every once in a while we see good things happen. We actually see the system, you know, work for what it's supposed to be doing. So,
Absolutely.
Congratulations on 36 years. You know, my wife and I, our last anniversary, I think it was our 19th anniversary, we were out campaigning, and someone asked us how long we were together. And, you know, we were so engrossed, so busy with everything that we're doing that we kind of forgot that day was our anniversary.
But yes, sir. Yes, sir. I understand.
Yeah, but you know, when you're doing things, you know, that you believe is right, things like that happen, and you know, absolutely. God says that, you know, we got to pick up our cross, right?
So, yes, sir. So, absolutely.
Pastor, can we start again? Just, you know, because we get new listeners every day. You know, it's been since April that you've been on. Can we talk a little bit about the IBSI or the Institute for Black Solidarity with Israel? Just, you know, again, a quick recap of what it is, why it exists, and why it's so important. And the third point to that, Pastor, so I don't interrupt you, is what does it mean by having black solidarity with Israel? Why just black?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. No, thank you, Peter, for the opportunity again. So, yeah, IBSI, Institute for Black Solidarity with Israel, founded in 2013. I started it shortly after my first trip to Israel in 2012. And I am a pastor, and a pastor who believes that the body of Christ is not a black, white, or Hispanic, or Asian entity. It is all nations, right? We recognize that. So, great question. Why the black part of it, Peter? I was in Israel 2012, December, praying at the Western Wall. And Israel was already a passion of mine. I'd already done some studies where Africa is concerned and the persecuted church all over the world, but especially what's going on in Sudan and places like Sudan and Mauritania and in Nigeria. And while I was there, God just placed it on my heart to strengthen these ties. These are deep, deep historic ties when it comes to in America, to black and Jewish communities, whether it's civil rights movement, whether it's education, Booker T. Washington, Julius Rosenwald. There's some deep, deep ties that are there, particularly when you're talking about the journey of black American Christians from the Negro spirituals and the slave plantations and those types of things. This journey that has been this black Christian thing here in the United States has been such a definitive thing, not just in that community, but for many, many different ways. And so this was something that's a much, much more of a heritage, if you will. So, when we talk about those who were the abolitionist people, like whether it was Frederick Douglass, whether it was Harry Tubman, these were deep, deep believing Christians, right? This was not happenstance for them. This was a God journey for them, and it is a heritage that they passed down that they wanted to make sure that their families and their communities recognized and understood and remembered God's faithfulness and his goodness. So that's a part of it that's there. Unfortunately, in the modern discussion where Israel is concerned, we've been doing this for a really long time, Israel is consistently demonized in a specific way. It's always called the racist state. It's always called an apartheid state. It's always said that it discriminates against Arabs or Africans or those types of things. None of those things are true. But what they have done, they've caused damage when it comes to using what we call that black story of liberty from slave to freedom or the whole the justice issue. These types of things that were good things, right, fighting for people's real equality, not the fake equality that the left talks about, but a real equality in terms of people being judged the same under the law. Like we were just celebrating today that people should be the same under the law. These were things that these older black Americans and men and women had to fight for, and they fought with different ones, white people, whether they were Jewish, whether people came together from the abolition of slavery to the Voting Rights Act, all those types of things, right? So what we have found in that organization that it's important that people in the black community speak out, just like on any other issue. You were just saying just a moment ago, Peter, that your proud heritage as a Puerto Rican, you speak out and you say things that other people might think that as a Puerto Rican you should not be saying. You should be on the left, you should be progressive, whatever. And there are times when you're having to say what you're saying at a defense of democracy, defense of a constitutional republic, freedom in this nation. And as you're doing that, you're giving strength to others who may be either from your background or from others who are just watching you in your courage and in your relentlessness defending the freedom of a nation for everyone. We found that we have to be a voice in the black community that is a trumpet call for everyone to be able to hear and get the truth.
Now, I mean, Christianity in general, but specifically that relationship with Israel, I mean, that is, you said it was deep-rooted in the black culture.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Absolutely.
And can you expound on that a little bit?
Absolutely. So what we have here, Peter, and I wrote it in my book, Zionism in the Black Church, and anybody can check it out. You go to the website, IBSI.org, and it's there on the website on the store there. I write about it in the book at great length. When we talk about this journey, first of all, when you're talking about people of African descent, when you're reading in the Bible, all these things that happened to Israel happened in Africa. Egypt is in Africa. Sinai, Africa. That's where they refused the Torah. That's where they were in bondage for 430 years. All of these things happened around this time. So there was always, in this region was known, right? This was already known. But when you're fast forwarding to the New World, right, in the United States, what you had was a deep identification with not just the, obviously the God of Israel, both as Christians, also as Bible students. What you had was everything from the songs on the plantations, those types of things like Go Down Moses and Joshua at the Battle of Jericho, songs that many people know from all different backgrounds. These songs were sung by slaves on the plantation as they called out to God, the same God who delivered Moses and the children of Israel from Egypt. There's the belief that he would do the same thing. And this is why virtually all of those black and white abolitionists and those leaders were devout Christians. Some of them were called the Radical Republicans. We remember the Republican Party was founded as an anti-slavery party. These were deep, abiding Christians who did not want the scourge of slavery to stain the United States of America. And this was a deep, deep faith where the black community was concerned, right up to like a Frederick Douglass, who encourages black soldiers to fight in the Civil War. That's how deep this goes.
Pastor, we'll be right back right after these few minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to the Next Step Show right here on WYSL. We'll be right back.
Just a little uncertainty can bring it down.
In the Rochester and Finger Lakes region, one name stands above all others for real estate appraisal and advice.
Ryan Murphy and Associates.
This full-service real estate appraisal company can appraise and advise on purchase and sales decisions, mortgage finance feasibility, estate, matrimonial, partnership buyouts, litigation, and more for any type of property, both residential and commercial. Ryan Murphy was founded almost 40 years ago. All of our highly trained staff members have at least 20 years of experience. All our appraisers are either New York State certified, general or residential real estate appraisers.
Ryan Murphy and Associates.
Start here. RYNNEMurphy.com.
For the last couple of years, Joe Robach has been telling you about Flower City Collision in Henrietta, saying that it was started by a veteran along with his son, Zach. Hi, my name is Greg Sadwick, and I am that veteran. I want to thank the WYSL listeners for their support over the last couple of years. During those years, not only have I experienced the gratification of providing you the best repairs and customer service, it has also allowed me the opportunity to see my son develop as a young professional. So remember, Flower City Collision for your collision repair needs, and thank you for supporting our locally owned family business.
Youth for Christ Rochester is growing. With the help from the John R. Wegman Foundation, we're adding Saturday mornings back to basketball, while the Saunders Foundation brings back skills and drills for the spring and summer. Our middle school girls program will be starting in a second school this fall. Watch for a new name change for that program. But we need your help. Make a one-time gift of $300 or a monthly gift of $25 to sponsor a kid for a year. Go to yfcrochester.org/donate.
Now that the good weather's back, you'll want to make sure your vehicle is in tip-top shape, whether it's for the daily commute or that vacation you're planning. For quality, affordable vehicle service, rely on Rock Auto Service, 1132 Westridge Road. Rock Auto has what your car, truck, or SUV needs. Oil change, brake service, suspension, alignments, exhaust, air conditioning, and tires. Check their Google reviews as one of Rochester's best for customer satisfaction. Rock Auto Service, 1132 Westridge, just east of Mount Reed, 434-5010.
Peter Vasquez and Next Step Show on the WYSL stations.
You are taking Next Steps along with Peter Vasquez and our fine sponsors of this program, Rock Auto Service on Westridge Road near Mount Reed, the real estate appraisal firm of Ryan Murphy and Associates, residential and commercial, Rochester and the Finger Lakes, decades of experience to help you out, and Flower City Collision. Again, here's Peter.
Thank you very much. So, hey, check this out, ladies and gentlemen. Deuteronomy, jeepers, I always mess that name up in the Bible. 1 verse 8 says, "See, I have given you this land. Go in and take possession of the land the Lord swore he would give to you, your father. to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and to their descendants after them. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Next Step Show. See, on the phone, tenemos the founder and CEO of the Institute for Black Solidarity with Israel, the Honorable Pastor Dumisani Washington. Sir, thank you for staying with us.
No problem, Peter. Thanks for having me.
So, hey, what's happening in Israel now? I mean, they just, you know, had a big... Yeah. Big, you know, a big fight there, and
yeah. Absolutely. So most people may know already there's been a war going to this ninth month between Israel and Hamas, which is based in Gaza. This was after Hamas had invaded Israel on October the 7th of last year and killed some 1,300 Israelis. Israelis and foreign nationals, and abducted some 200 plus more. There's still over 100 kidnapped victims still there in Gaza right now. We don't know if they are all alive. We're hoping that they're still alive. And again, I want to emphasize that when Hamas did that and they came in, they killed Israeli Jews, Muslims, Christians, foreign nationals, people from Asia, people from Africa. They didn't really care. Whoever they could get their hands on, they killed those people. And Israel has now been in Gaza for the last going on 9 months, rooting out Hamas, fighting Hamas there. But also, there's a war that's already broken out. So Gaza is to Israel's south. So Lebanon is to Israel's north. And the terrorist group that rules that region is called Hezbollah. Now, people should know that both Hamas in Gaza to the south and Hezbollah to the north in Lebanon are all controlled by the Islamic Republic of Iran. Iran is the puppet master, if you will. They fund multiple terrorist groups that are not just in the region where Israel is, but around the world. Iran is the number one state sponsor of global terrorism, and their primary focus is Israel, and their next focus is us, which is why you already have terrorists, including Hezbollah agents, throughout the United States, and they've been here for decades. None of this is new. They've been in Latin America. Unfortunately, they've been throughout different parts of Mexico, and they have been in the United States for a very, very long time. Israel is fighting that war right now.
So I want to ask you a question, Pastor, and I don't know if this is more of a philosophical type of question or a religious question, but can you tell for our listeners, because there always seems to be when there's dialogue, when there's discussion, we talk of Jews as Jews and then everybody else. Can you tell us how and if Jews differ from the rest of the world?
Well, there's a only in the sense, Peter, the two things in terms of, you just read this Bible verse there in Deuteronomy, which is part of the law that God gave through Moses to the children of Israel as they were journeying to the promised land. God calls Israel a called out people. This was him. He said they are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, the same verses that Peter uses to refer to the church in 1 Peter, right? So he uses those same verses that he's actually taken out of the book of Exodus, right? So yes, the Jewish people, according to the word of God, are God's chosen in the sense that he selected them to bring the Torah, the word of God, to the world, as well as the Messiah who's come through Israel, right? And at the same time, the land that he's given. When he called Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, he made a covenant with Israel, with Abraham and his descendants, that he would be his God. That's why he calls himself the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and that he was going to take him to a land. We know that now is the land of Canaan. This was the promise that God made. In that sense, yes, the Jewish people are those descendants. Whether those Jewish people were discarded and dispersed after all these wars to Africa, to Asia, to Europe, they are the children of Israel, if you will, right? Does that make them better than? And people often get into that type of, are they better? No. As a matter of fact, the word of God even tells Israel, I didn't choose you because you were the best or because you were the greatest. As a matter of fact, I chose you because you were the least among nations, right? So this is not a situation where the Bible teaches or that we in preaching it believe that somehow a Jewish person is better than another person. This is called a calling. A calling is that they are chosen by God to bring this light and to bring it. Is, remember what he said to Abraham, I will bless those who bless you, curse those who curse you, and through you the nations of the earth will be blessed. Well, as Christians, we believe that ultimate blessing was that through the lines of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob came Jesus. The word of God says he's a lion out of that tribe of Judah, right? This is the blessing that God has been to the world, and he's done that through the nation of Israel.
So I believe the verse in Exodus that you're referring to is Exodus 6, verses 7 and 8, where it says, I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians, and I will bring you to the land I swore with uplifted hands to give to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. I will give it to you as a possession. I am the Lord.
So, yes, absolutely.
So, Pastor, when you were on back in April, I had asked you about, this the most common anti-Israel or Israel is wrong type of discussion. It's always focused around the prime minister. But I have several. I mean, just for this show, I have a few Bible quotes that shows the justification isn't political. It's biblical, and if I may, let me share a couple of these. Genesis 12, sure. For example, verses 1 through 3. It says, the Lord had said to Abram, go from your country, your people, your father's household, to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you. I mean, that's just three verses that we've read right now out of many. What would we say to people to understand that? How can we prove that it's not a political support, it's an overall biblical support that we have for Israel as a nation?
No, that's a good question, Peter. So what you have and what you've always had from ancient Israel to this day, you've had the spiritual reality of God's relationship. Again, this was a God thing. God is the one who called Abraham. God is the one who called his descendants to be his chosen people. This is what he actually says in the Word of God. But what you've also had is the reality, including the political reality, of a nation of Israel, particularly since after you want to go back to the king, part of King David, King Saul, right? There's been this quote-unquote state of Israel, if you're talking about a political state, as well as the spiritual reality. These things aren't in conflict, though they do take us to really have to understand what it is that we're looking at. In other words, use the example of King David, who was the second king. I'm just using it as an example. He was the second king after Saul. The Word of God even called David a man after his own heart. He said this through Samuel, who was the prophet that anointed David. Yet, David was as imperfect a man and imperfect a leader as anyone, right? I mean, people who don't even know the Bible know about David and Bathsheba, right? So the situation where here's David, here's this righteous man, he's this warrior, he fights Goliath, he does all these amazing things, and, oh, by the way, he also sinned egregiously, took a man's wife, got that man killed, right? So what do we say about that, right? Well, oh my gosh, David did these bad things, so clearly he's not God's chosen to be king. Well, it is, and for all the Christians who are listening, what I always remind people of is that in your walk with God and him calling you and drawing you to himself, you, if you're like any other human being, may have made some mistakes between the time you gave your heart to God and now, and God didn't throw you away. God didn't discard you. That's often how I will tell Christians when they're thinking about the whole Israel thing. Well, Pastor Masani, I saw this thing, and Israel's in a war, and this is going on, and these things are happening. Or Prime Minister Netanyahu, he said this, he did this, and how can these be the chosen people of God? And I always chuckle. I said, you know, it's amazing. When we do it as Christians, somehow God has grace. If somebody else do it, we need him to bring down the hammer, right? We want him to go ahead and boom, he needs to deal with this. Those Jews, they did this, that, and the other, or whatever, and especially the propaganda, right? Oh, my God, Israel's committing genocide. People, Israel is not committing genocide. That is not happening. And these lies happen all the time, right? But people will say or see these things, and they'll try to reconcile what's this spiritual thing and this physical reality thing. They're not in conflict with each other. That just really is how it happens when there's a calling on someone's life, and at the same time, that person is a human being.
Pastor, I'm going to read Joshua 1, verses 2 through 4. It says, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give you, or to give to them, excuse me, and to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the great river to Euphrates. And to the heady country, to the Mediterranean Sea, into the west. I mean, that seems pretty specific, and it seems to be much of what's in question and where the wars are coming from there.
Yes, sir. Well, it's funny because that what you just read there, historically, Peter, it's funny, Israel has never possessed all of that land, right? It would be, if you were to see it on a map, the current state of Israel is tiny compared to the land that actually got promised. So those of us who believe the Bible believe at some point God will make good on the rest of that promise, right? But right now, Israel has a sliver of that and is always at war with those people who don't want them to be there at all.
When we get back, Pastor, I want to ask you a question that's semi-political, and I'll give you a hint. It's, should they go and take all that land now? Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to your conservative New Eureka Naki on the WYSL stations. Hey, if you've got to leave the radio, no problem. Open up your Facebook, your Twitter, your Instagram, and guess what? You can take us with you. We'll be right back right here on WYSL.
Peter Vasquez and Next Step Show on the WYSL stations.
Don't forget, the podcast is always available at WYSL1040.com. And let's see, we stream, Peter, just about everywhere, right?
And we do, everywhere. Every major podcasting platform out there. And check it out, too. Yeah, I also have it on the Next Step, at least the show. I have it on the NextStepShow.com. And even then, if the website isn't somebody, they can go to I got like an online radio station. I'm not a rival, though. Don't worry about it. I promise. There's like this.
Scaring me.
You can catch WYSL's shows on all the platforms. You can catch the Next Step Show live every day on all the platforms.
Does ScrewTube let you? Do they not toss you off?
Who's that? Which one?
YouTube?
No, they do slap my hand sometimes because of my music, but they haven't censured anything that I've put out yet.
No, not content based.
No.
Now that I've said it, their bots have probably shut us down.
They're like, oh, we should probably look there a little closer. But you know, the things that we talk about is true and honest and dialogue. We're not doing anything that's one sided at all. Like today's show, Dumisani, thank you for staying with us, and you know. Before a break, Pastor, we were talking about Joshua 1, verses 2 and 4, where it kind of lays out the land that the Lord had promised, his people, right? And you had mentioned that they didn't, you know, if you look at the map, they don't really own any of that. So I left that last segment asking, should they? Is the time now? Is it time for this to say, no mas? You know what? We're going to take this land, and that's it.
Well, in terms of the land that was promised biblically, I really honestly, Peter, can't answer that. I think it's a timing thing. In other words, Israel as a nation and then even the nations around them, it will happen if we believe the Bible. But whether or not Israel should initiate something like that, I couldn't answer that. I can only speak to, in terms of the political reality, what's happening now. For example, because of the war in Lebanon that's coming, sponsored by Iran, Israel has to fight. And again, for people to understand, not just a war, a battle about land. This is an existential war. Iran is not bringing Hezbollah and the Islamic Jihad and Hamas, all these different groups around Israel, just to fight them and cause them some problems. They want to wipe out Israel and kill every Jew on the planet. Like when you asked me earlier, Peter, about the whole Jews, are they different? What is that whole thing about the Jews? Well, that whole being called and chosen, what the Bible also teaches us is that Israel will always be attacked by the other nations, and God will always defend Israel. And this is what we've been seeing going on for thousands of years. So Iran, with its proxies, is not interested in taking some land and free Palestine and Lebanon, none of that. But they want Israel gone, and, well, by the way, they want the United States gone. What do they say? They say death to Israel and death to America. The protesters who are on the college campuses, who are on city streets around the United States of America, they are burning U.S. flags and Israel flags, right? They're saying death to Israel and death to America, right? They have a global caliphate in mind, and it starts with first trying to destroy Israel. So should Israel take it? At some point, they'll have all of it, but should they do something like that now? I couldn't answer that. That has to be more of an Israeli answer, but they do have to fight and maintain what they do have. Otherwise, Israel's enemies will try to wipe out all of the Jews, both there and around the world.
And to restate, Dumisani, you know, what I said at the last show, the Next Step Show, the Prime Minister is always welcomed. If he ever wanted some airtime to, you know, to talk directly to people, even take calls if he, you know, if he had the time.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Funny, I saw that note, Pete, that you sent me back in April. For some reason, it popped up on something on one of my devices. It just did. It was so funny. And I reached out to a couple of my friends that were there. It's been obviously crazy there. But I did put a couple of feelers out and everything. So as soon as I know for sure, I'll definitely connect you all, because I don't know the Prime Minister personally. I've never, you know, spoken with him directly, but I know he's done press a lot like that before. So I'm sure someone from his office would want to connect and say something to the people.
Absolutely. And the thing is this, you know, there's such a distress between we the people and the people in office, or its government functions right now, that it's kind of, and the news, it's kind of hard not to, you know, to look at it and be like, gosh, you know, I really want to believe it, But you have to hesitate. So it's nice to hear directly and have that opportunity to ask questions. Pastor, this is kind of a silly question. I was watching a movie called Left Behind. It's a movie that's been around for a while, remade a couple of times. I personally like the Kirk Cameron version. But in there, they talk about the 7 years of tribulation, and I guess, you know, ladies and gentlemen, you'd have to kind of refer to the Bible to really understand this. But it talks about the 7 years of tribulation with the Antichrist, kind of lead stuff. And it says it would start when Israel signs a treaty with its enemies. Is that something that's real? Can you talk on that? Can we debunk that? I mean, is that something that makes sense at all?
Well, biblically, one of the things that's referred to that's commonly known, I believe it's in the book of Jeremiah chapter 30, around verse 7, it refers to what we call now the time of Jacob's trouble. God speaks through the prophet Jeremiah, and he's talking about the end times or the coming of Messiah, these things that will usher in the coming of Messiah, right? That there will be a time of great turmoil on Israel as the nations come against Israel. We believe as Christians also that the Antichrist figure will wage war against Israel. He will lead the nations in a war against Israel, and then God will come and defend Israel. Now, will that be triggered by a peace treaty? That's possible. I don't think that that's clear scripturally, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it won't happen. What it's doing is, Peter, fascinating, like the question you asked in the beginning, it is that spiritual and political reality combining, right? Here you have the spiritual reality of God calling Israel, Jerusalem being the city of God. We to this day call it the city of the great king. And then the Bible also teaches that the nations will come against Jerusalem, meaning coming against the city of God. But oh, what? Guess what? Jerusalem's also the capital of Israel, just like our Washington, D.C. It says that the nations will come against Israel at its very heart, at its very core. This is what we do see happening right now. Israel has peace treaties. It has peace treaties with people like Jordan, and Jordan's causing problems. It has with peace treaties with Egypt, and Egypt has been feeding weapons and to Hamas. And so you've had they have relationships with other nations that are not really abiding by those relationships. So, yes, something like that could trigger it, where Israel has a peace treaty and those nations turn on them. That could be a trigger. But scripturally, we don't know if that's exactly how that's going to happen. But we do know that the nations of the earth will come against Israel, just like we see it happening right now in the United Nations.
It's almost hard not to think that we're not living out the last days, you know, when you read stuff like that.
Peter, to your point right there, I've been doing this for years. This is the first time in my life that I have heard as many rabbis and pastors say exactly what you said. I've heard rabbis say, this is the coming of Messiah. These are the footsteps of Messiah. And Christian pastors say Jesus is coming back. I mean, but they're saying that what we're seeing right now, on both sides, both the Christian and the Jewish side, that they're saying here is the coming of Messiah. What we're seeing now are the events that are – none of them have been predicting exactly when, but what they've been saying that these events are leading to the coming of Messiah.
So I'm going to shift focus a little bit, Pastor. I want to I want you to put your pastor hat on full on here. Because I do, in our last show in April, on April 16th, ladies and gentlemen, this is Pastor Dumisani Washington, right? But I want to talk about the attack on Christianity in general. Anybody who says, I love Jesus, Jesus is my, you know, my strength, he's my rock, I mean, anything, right? And to be honest, I had to go and watch that movie Left Behind again because there's so many parallels in those movies to what we're seeing now. It's scary, right? But for example, in Timothy 3, verse 12, it says, and these are the New International Version version that I'm reading, by the way. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Right? I mean, that's stated right in Timothy 3:12. Matthew 5:10, verses 10 through 12 says, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is in the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecute the prophets who were before you. So can I ask why? I mean, we live in America who's based in Judeo-Christian values. I mean, they were escaping persecution from the European church, basically, right? Why are we where we are if we're not to draw parallels to the end of times?
That is the $100,000 question, Peter. You nailed it. You just nailed it. That is exactly what the Word of God says. And the church in the United States of America has largely been shielded from that type of persecution for the 2.5 centuries that we've existed. It has been in this later age of these past several decades that more and more, the more secular our nation becomes, the more anti-God, the more atheist. If you notice, those who are listening, remember a couple of decades ago, it was all about atheism, but now it's all about Satan worship. I mean, they have demons in the schools with these kids. The whole trans thing, they'll dress up, not just as trans, but as demons, have these goat heads on. They have all these things. What in the world is going on? Why is our nation straight up embracing witchcraft and the worship of death? Even non-religious people have come to me and say, Pastor Dumisani, what is going on? Why are they worshiping demons? That's because we are a nation that has turned away from God, and the persecution is coming quickly.
Absolutely. And you know what? Listen, if the devil's got you beat, you're right. He's going to leave you alone. So if your life is warm and fuzzy and copacetic without any issues, you may want to consider what you're doing. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back right here on the Next Step Show on WYSL.
In the Rochester and Finger Lakes region, one name stands above all others for real estate appraisal and advice.
Ryan Murphy and Associates.
This full-service real estate appraisal company can appraise and advise on purchase and sales decisions, mortgage finance feasibility, estate, matrimonial, partnership buyouts, litigation, and more for any type of property, both residential and commercial. Ryan Murphy was founded almost 40 years ago. All of our highly trained staff members have at least 20 years of experience. All our appraisers are either New York State certified, general, or residential real estate appraisers.
Ryan Murphy and Associates.
Start here. RYNNEMurphy.com.
Hi, my name is Greg Sadwick, and along with my son Zach, we are the owners of Flower City Collision. We've been advertisers on WISL, the voice of liberty, for the last couple of years. So I want to thank the listeners of WISL for their patronage, which has allowed us to grow and reinvest in the latest technologies to ensure that your vehicles are repaired to the most current standards, whether conventional or EV. If you're in a collision, reach out to Zach at Flower City Collision in Henrietta, and he'll work with your national insurance company on your local behalf to ensure that your repair gets done right.
Baseball, hot dogs, and the American flag. They're all part of the rich fabric that makes our country great. Show your American spirit by purchasing your flag from the Stars and Stripes Flag Store today. When you do, you're supporting critically needed services for local veterans at the Veterans Outreach Center. Let's show our veterans that we care by placing our nation's symbol on the porch of every house in our community. The Stars and Stripes Flag Store, 783 South Avenue, Rochester, or visit eflagstore.com.
Now that the good weather's back, you'll want to make sure your vehicle is in tip-top shape. Whether it's for the daily commute or that vacation you're planning. For quality, affordable vehicle service, rely on Rock Auto Service, 1132 Westridge Road. Rock Auto has what your car, truck, or SUV needs. Oil change, brake service, suspension, alignments, exhaust, air conditioning, and tires. Check their Google reviews as one of Rochester's best for customer satisfaction. Rock Auto Service, 1132 Westridge, just east of Mount Reed, 434-5010.
Next Steps with Peter Vasquez on the WYSL stations.
Welcome back to the Next Step Show, ladies and gentlemen. Si, gracias for hanging out with me. And as always, si, it is my pleasure to have lunch with you every day, Monday through Friday. And remember, we're on now live when I'm in studio right here on all the social media platforms. So take us with you. I promise if we go to the bathroom with you, we won't peek. I think we said that before, just in case. Pastor, thank you for hanging out with us, sir.
Yes, sir. No problem.
Hey, I got a quick question for you. And again, just another political question. But do you have any insight on the recent debate that we have?
Well, you know what? I have a few, but I'll stick on the Israel thing for now. There was one thing that that Biden said among many, right? And since we're just on this Israel thing, he made a statement about the weapons shipment. We have a military relationship with Israel, as we do with many nations around the world. Israel also singled out because of the anti-Jewish thing, whatever. But he said that he had not stopped weapons shipments to Israel, which is not true. He did. And he said that he was not shipping the 2,000-pound bombs that Israel has requested because he said that he was concerned about civilians being hurt. First of all, Israel has the lowest casualty terrorist rate in terms of killings in the world. In other words, Israel, as heinous and as bad as this is, and this war is ugly, and yes, unfortunately, innocent people have died. Israel has limited those types of casualties better than any other nation. Number two, the bombs that he stopped shipping are actually needed to fight Hezbollah in Lebanon. So that was one of the many things that the president said that were completely not true or very misleading, right? As well as some other things I could get all into. So I noticed that he kept calling Trump a liar at X, Y, and Z, right? But the problem was that for him, much of what he said was demonstrably untrue. We have all the receipts, as the young people would say. And I've noticed those things kind of playing out in the talk. My feeling is that he says those things anyway because the people who are most loyal to Biden and to the progressives are going to vote. They don't care what he says or what he does, unfortunately. And I'll say this last thing as well. Because of the millions of illegal immigrants who have come, and they've come from around over the border, from around the world, from Afghanistan, from Syria, from Pakistan, we know that this is the case. And some of them have ties to terrorism. There's just an article that came out a couple of weeks ago about some of them may very well be connected to ISIS. This is the state of our national security. So we're talking about Israel's fight being our fight. We are allowing people to come who are actually terrorists to come over the border and not even checking who they are, or at the very least not detaining them and sending them back. This is actually the most dangerous time we probably have had in our nation, as a nation.
Absolutely. Pastor, I truly appreciate our conversations. I'm so grateful for your willingness to come on our show. Do you have any next steps advice that you could share with our listeners, whether it's to get a hold of you and get involved or whatever they can do even in their own backyard?
Sure, Peter. And I appreciate that as well. With the last question, the second last question you asked about the persecution, as a pastor, I've been someone who's followed the persecution of the church around the world for the last 30 years. I started doing this in the 1990s, right? And so we are seeing that type of persecution in different parts of the world, Christians in China, Christians in Iran, in Nigeria, in Sudan, and on and on. So for the people who want to know more about that and to see what they can do, the Institute for Black Solidarity with Israel has joined in with a group called the African Jewish Alliance that's actually bringing not just more awareness, but we're actually going to our lawmakers to races and say something about what's going on. So they could just go to our website, IBSI.org, or it's the AfricanJewishAlliance.org. That's another one you can join and find out about what we're doing. It's Jews, Christians. There are even Muslims.
Hey, Pastor, you're breaking up pretty bad there. We're only catching every other word from you.
Oh,
I'll tell
sorry,
you,
Pastor.
See, Satan doesn't bother you when there's not a reason to, and there's a reason to.
Yes, sir, I'm sorry. Can
it's
you
either
okay?
Satan or the government, but I repeat myself.
If you can just say what you said again, I'd appreciate that.
Yeah, absolutely, no problem. They can go to AfricanJewishAlliance.org and find out more about the group that we are working with to actually put more pressure on our government about what's going on with Nigeria, Sudan, the Christians around the world who are being persecuted, even as you mentioned, Peter. But I also, so you'll know, I started a new radio show. It's on Sundays at 4 p.m. Eastern. They can go to TTPLive.com, Truth to Power, what's called Truth to Power with Dumisani Washington, TTPLive.com. You can stream the radio show from there on once a week on Sunday at 4 p.m. Eastern. And our last show last week, we just talked about this very thing, the African Jewish Alliance and what's going on with terrorism and what we can do to be a part of the solution to what's going on as well.
Hey, Pastor, if I can just throw a plug in there for this wonderful station that I have the privilege to be on the air for. You know, the stuff you got to share, I think it may be worth you giving the Voice of Liberty, Senor Roberto Sabaje, a call, because it seems to me, at least in all the conversations that I've had with you, that whatever it is you got to say live on your Truth to Power radio, you know, you may want to consider a potential streaming here with the Senor Sabaje if there's something you guys can work out. Because, listen, people got to hear the truth. Too many people are not, and it's creating too many anti-Americans.
Peter, I would love to. As a matter of fact, the only reason why we've done a radio show, we just started about a few weeks ago, is because we had some colleagues in New York who reached out and said, hey, would you like to do this? And our family got together, we talked about it, and boom, we started it. But, yeah, we would love to partner with you all there and stream it or however we can connect it. So please shoot me a note. I'll connect it with the staff, and we would love to make that happen, Peter.
Tell you what, if you can hang on the line when we wrap up this call, the producer, Bob D'Angelo, will take down some contact info from you.
That'd be great. That'd be great.
Super duper. And how can people get a hold of you, Pastor?
The best way is to go either of those websites. You can go to IBSI.org, and you can either join our newsletter or you can just go to the contact there as well and reach out to me. That's the best way because the emails come to me, to my personal thing. So the staff will get it and then connect us together. Or go to now the radio show, ttplive.com. You can also click there on a contact and send it to that staff as well. And then I can hear from you within the next 24 hours.
Thank you so much for your time, Pastor. I will have you on again in the next few months.
No problem, Peter. Anytime, let me know.
Yep. God bless. Let me know about the Prime Minister if you hear something.
I sure will, Peter.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know. Bob, do we have time for a call? Maybe a quick one if they hustle?
Nah, probably not. You got about a minute left.
But listen, I am on Facebook, so check it out. You can drop me a comment at any time. We'd be more than glad to share it. But check it out, though, ladies and gentlemen. If you're a Christian, you know what? I'm going to say it this way. If you're an individual who loves American values like God, country, and family, listen, for crying out loud, pick up something other than mainstream media so that you can see and hear what's happening. We've got a buffoon in the White House, a magician in the State House. We've got people that are saying that they're Democrats because they love their kids, but yet they support everything that's destroying this country and the future of our children. So listen, check this out. I'm going to leave you a couple quotes before I leave. Right? John 15, verses 18 through 20 says, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates me. Remember what I told you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecute me, they will persecute you also. If they obey my teachings, they will obey yours also. Ladies and gentlemen, listen, be a leader. Be a leader. Be a leader. Stand for what's right. If you're running for office, but you're running away from God, you are wrong. Check it out. Say it with me. Leadership is the beacon that guides me, for it's through selfless service that I illuminate the way for others to find their own greatness. Y mira, nunca te olvides aquí en the WYSL stations, La Voz de Libertad, the Next Step Show to conservative New York Rican Peter Vasquez, siempre te amamos.